May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Good afternoon, everyone. And on behalf of the good people of St. Peter's Parish, Guelph, I would like to welcome all to the funeral ceremony of Letsa Carlyle Glean. And I want to welcome in a very special way the bishop here, represented by the Vicar General, Father Carl, and all members of the clergy and the religious. I would like to welcome the Governor General, Her Excellency Dame Cecile Lagranade, the Prime Minister Honorable, the Right Dr. Kiel Mitchell, Parliament ministers and other government functionaries here present, members of the Royal Grenada Police Force, family members, parishioners, friends, and well wishers, and all those joining from different social platforms. Thank you for joining us to pray for the happy repose of the soul of Sir Carlyle Glean. May his soul and the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
And so, to celebrate these sacred mysteries worthily, let us call to mind our sins, ask God for mercy and pardon. I confess to the Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters,
that I have sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do,
through my fault,
therefore I ask the Blessed Mary, the
Virgin, all you angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters,
pray for me.
May the Almighty God have mercy on us. May he forgive all our sins and bring us a life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who are mercy for sinners and the happiness of your saints, give, we pray, to your servant, for whom today we perform the fraternal offices of burial, Sir Carlyle Glean, a share with your chosen ones in the blessedness you give, so that on the day of resurrection, freed from the bonds of mortality, he may come before your face. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
I will be seated, please.
The virtuous man, though he die before his time, will find rest. Length of days is not what makes age honorable, nor number of years the true measure of life. Understanding, this is man's gray years. Untarnished life, this is ripe old age. He has sought to please God, so God has loved him. As he was living among sinners, he has been taken up, he has been carried off, so that evil may not warp his understanding, or treachery seduce his soul. For the fascination of evil throws good things into the shade, and the real ruin of desire corrupts a simple heart. Coming to perfection in so short a while, he achieved long life, his soul being pleasing to the Lord. He has taken up quickly from the wickedness around him. Yet people look on, uncomprehending. It does not enter the head that grace and mercy await the chosen of the Lord, and protection his holy one. This is the word of the Lord.
You have anointed with oil. Who accompanied them on the guitar. We will now listen to the second reading, which will be taken from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. And this reading will be proclaimed by Mr. Carlyle Glean III. So, we will listen to this reading.
With God on our side, who can be against us? Since God did not spare his own son, but gave him up to benefit us all, we may be certain after such a gift that he will not refuse anything he can give. Could anyone accuse those that God has chosen? When God acquits, could anyone condemn? Could Christ Jesus? No. He not only died for us, he rose from the dead. And there at God's right hand, he stands and pleads for us. Nothing, therefore, can come between us and the love of Christ, even if we are troubled or worried, or being persecuted, or lacking food or clothes, or being threatened or even attacked. These are the trials through which we triumph, by the power of him who loved us. For I am certain of this, neither death nor life, no angel, no prince, nothing that exists, nothing still to come, not any power or height or depth, nor any created thing can ever come between us and the love of God, made visible in Christ Jesus. Our Lord. The word of the Lord.
And now we have a gospel acclamation and we sing the Alleluia lustily because the word of God, the gospel, will be proclaimed following this. So the congregation is invited to stand.
My Father has blessed, says the Lord. Take for your heritage the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world.
From the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, escorted by all glory. All the nations will be assembled before him, and he will separate men one from another as shepherds separates sheep from goats. He will place the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left, foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you made me welcome. Naked, and you clothed me. Sick, and you visited me. In prison, and you came to see me. Then the virtuous will say to him in reply, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and make you welcome, naked and clothe you, sick or in prison, and go to see you? And the king will answer, I tell you solemnly, insofar as you did this to one of the least of these brothers, you did it to me. Next, he will say to those on his left hand, go away from me with a curse upon you to the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you never gave me food. I was thirsty, and you never gave me to drink. I was a stranger, and you never made me feel welcome. Naked, and you never clothed me. Sick and in prison, and you never visited me. Then it will be their turn to ask, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, a stranger or naked, sick or in prison, and did not come to your help? Then he will answer, I tell you solemnly, insofar as you neglected to do this to one of the least of these, you neglected to do it to me. And they will go away to eternal punishment, and the virtues to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This proclaimed, we have the homily, and Reverend Deacon Carlyle Glean Jr., the son of the late Carlyle Glean, will now deliver the homily to us. What a moment of courage. We listen aptly to what he will be saying today and admire his courage to be able to do the homily in place perhaps of Father John George, a parish priest.
The day was December 23rd, 2021, third night prayers. I was asked to proclaim the gospel of the day, which was taken from Luke chapter 1, verses 57 to 66. It's a passage that deals with the circumcision and naming of John the Baptist when he was only 8 years old. And there was some discussion among the elders, those present, and the parents about the name. What name should John the Baptist have? And so they went to the father, who could not speak, and he wrote on a tablet, his name is John. When he said that, his speech returned, and all present was filled with awe. And they said, in verse 66, the hand of the Lord was with him. Referring to John the Baptist, 8 days old, they recognized that the hand of the Lord was with John the Baptist. And so, the first time our family and friends were meeting to pray for the repose of the soul of Sir Carl, the scripture reminded us that even at an early age, the hand of God could be with you. The hand of God could be with you, as was recognized by the hill country, the people of the hill country of Judea, in that Luke's gospel passage. The hand of God was with him. You see, as a little boy, so Carl had to go sell fish or jacks, whatever came ashore, as part of his household chores before he went to school. Before he went to school on mornings, that meant that generally he would be late. But recounting as an adult, he told us, whenever there was an exam or any important activity, sales that day will be rapid. Sales that day will be rapid, and he would get to school on time, even though barely so. He recounted that from an early age, he recognized the hand of God in his life. And he didn't only recognize it, but he grew day by day to be dependent on it, the hand of God in his life. Recognizing the hand of God in our lives, brothers and sisters, is a trait that was passed. It's a trait that we pray that we would all start doing, brothers and sisters. We look for many things. We look for faults. We look for things to criticize. So as a people, let's follow the people of the hill country of Judea and look for the hand of God in our children's life and share it with them. Recall the hand of God in our own lives and share it with them, brothers and sisters. Share it. Share it. Looking for the hand of God in your lives. When we attempt it and it becomes a habit, the transformation would be untold, brothers and sisters. Looking for the hand of God in your lives. Looking for the hand of God in your lives. And last night we had a beautiful ceremony here where we prayed the Psalms. And there were two Psalms, two powerful Psalms, because it tells us Psalm 120, 130, and 121. Psalm 121 tells us where to look. I will lift up my eyes into the hills, from where cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Powerful Psalms, brothers and sisters. And Psalm 120, 130 tells us who we should be crying to. Out of the depths, I cry to you, O Lord, Lord, hear my voice. Let your ear be attentive to my cry for mercy. Powerful. Powerful. Brothers and sisters, evening prayers we had yesterday always end with a prayer that Catholics call the Magnificat. It's really taken from Luke chapter 1, 46 and continuing. My soul magnified the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. If I spend the rest of my life on my knees, I cannot thank God enough, brothers and sisters. These were the words frequently repeated by Sukkah. And when he says it, looking at him and he looking at you, brothers and sisters, you feel a soul. You feel it. It's coming from a soul that magnifies the Lord and from a spirit that rejoices in his Savior, brothers and sisters. His impoverished childhood years also allowed him to bear witness to the end of the Magnificat. He casts the mighty from the thrones, raises the lowly, fills the starving with good things, and sends the rich away empty. And so we pray today for all who may feel overwhelmed, hopeless, depressed. Keep the faith. Hold strong. God is near. He's always near. You see, we as men and women, boys and girls, there's a longing for God in our hearts, all of us. We are created by God and will not be fully at peace until we rest with Him. And so, on the ninth night after Sakal's passing, as family, baby sister Rose, and as usual, mobilize us to do the rosary. We gotta do something. Novena, the night collective prayer. And at the end of that, our mother broke into a spontaneous hymn. A hymn about the human condition and longing for God. Written by an American composer and medical mission sister, Miriam Therese Winter. I'll read only the first verse for you. Man is lonely by birth. Man is only a pilgrim on earth. Born to be king, time is but a temporary thing. Only alone while on earth. Brothers and sisters, that sister did a treatment of time as alone. It's temporary. It's only alone that we enjoy while we're on earth. Between our birth and our death, we are pilgrims. We are pilgrims. That recognition is important, brothers and sisters. We are pilgrims on the road to God. We are but travelers on a journey, pilgrims on a pilgrimage to our Lord. St. Augustine put it best. You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it rests in you. And so the question today is your heart restless? Or does it rest in its Maker, the God of mercy, God of grace? And so, yes, Sir Carlyle's journey began 89 years ago. But knowing that 89 years was the extent of his loan while on earth, brothers and sisters, the question today, are we gathered to mourn, or are we gathered for thanksgiving? Is it a spirit of mourning, a spirit of gratitude? It's hard to avoid the little mourning, but we are overwhelmed, brothers and sisters, by that spirit of gratitude. Gratitude triumphs. Thanksgiving to God for his life triumphs. Any sad moment that want to linger, that light of gratitude just flushes it out. Not that mourning is bad, but we cannot help it but to celebrate. Thanksgiving to God for the life. Life as a testimony. Life as a witness. So this gathering here this afternoon, brothers and sisters, we call it funeral. It's really an occasion for family, friends, well-wishers, and indeed, in Sir Carl's case, the entire country, to get together to express gratitude. To express gratitude. For us believers, we express that gratitude to God. For non-believers, please express it to whoever may be listening. Just be thankful. Whoever may be listening, brothers and sisters, and for everyone, to each other. For much appreciated kindness, love, solidarity. It's important. It's important because we live in a secular, consumeristic age, brothers and sisters, where we are told, where we are taught, where we are trained, where we are conditioned to focus on what we do not have, brothers and sisters, than what we do. Our polarized political and social culture tempts us to criticize more than compliment. And so occasions like these are special. It offers an opportunity where we can reset Reset, brothers and sisters. Reset. It's a time to reset. We are invited to reset. We're invited to detoxify, brothers and sisters. We're invited to purge the negativity. Purge it, brothers and sisters. Purge it. Purge it. And pray for the outpouring of that spirit of gratitude. We got to make room for the spirit of gratitude. Get the negativity out. Get it out. Spirit of gratitude. And we pray that outpouring on our own lives, the lives of our family and the country. See, as Catholics, we pray. Every time we celebrate Mass and it would come up, when our dear parish priest, Father John, continues, we pray at every Mass these words: it is right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give thanks, to give you thanks. It is right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Tell God thanks, always and everywhere, in season, out of season. We say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Powerful prayer, brothers and sisters. Powerful prayer. So occasions like these allow us to fulfill that sweet and fitting obligation for the gift of life and so much more. Give thanks. Give thanks. But thanksgiving, brothers and sisters, can also be an invitation, a lifeline cast into the pit of self-pity, brothers and sisters. Offering a path of escape. That's what thanksgiving do. Very powerful. When we buried in that pit of self-pity, if we could only muster the muscle to say, thank you, Lord, we start the healing, offering a path of escape from that pit of self-pity. Also offer permission and motivation to take it. It's all to win. Mourning or thanksgiving, we thank you, Lord. And in the life of Sakal, if for those who had the opportunity to meet him, interact with him, if the result, as a result of the interaction, you were not drawn closer to God, you may have missed the essence of his life. You may have missed the essence of his life. He lived for that. To draw others unto God, on whom his entire life depended. On whom his entire life depended. But even though you missed, brothers and sisters, today you know. So, better late than never. So as we leave here today, to lay Fisher Boy Ton Sir Carlyle to his final resting place, we pray. We pray for the grace to recognize and respond to the needs of our young boys and girls who are growing up in impoverished homes, especially those who lack the means to participate in the new education system on offer today. We pray. We recognize and respond to those needs. And we also pray for the continued outpouring of God's mercy on Sir Carlyle. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. Let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. And may the souls, his soul and the soul of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Wow. This is so very touching, so very moving. he stood up there with such courage to deliver this homily to us on the occasion of the death of his own father, but inviting us to be grateful, inviting us to be thankful, inviting us to have hope, and not even looking at their own situation, but thinking of other people, even at a time like this. We are invited now to stand for the prayers of the faithful, led by Father Marcin Rumick, Parish Priest of Blessed Sacrament, Grand Anse.
Christ, risen from the dead, and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus, we join our prayers to his. Our response will be, hear our prayer. In baptism, Sir Carlyle Glean received the light of Christ, scattered the darkness now and led him over the waters of death. Lord, in your mercy, our brother, Sir Carlyle, was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy. Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. Lord, in your mercy. Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these signs against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. Lord, in your mercy. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all whose faith is known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy. The family and friends of Sir Carlyle seek comfort and consolation. Heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Lord, in your mercy. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother, Sir Carlyle. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your Son's coming. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Begins with the preparation of the gifts. The deacon assisting at this Mass is Deacon Anthony Joseph.
At this time, we will now be engaging in the collection offering. This offering will be for the Hillsview Home for the Aged. For those of you who may have received envelopes as you entered into the church, your collection contribution can be placed within those envelopes. For those of you who may not have envelopes, that is okay. We will accept your contributions for this very important collection. In terms of the order for the process of a collection, please be mindful that you will be directed by ushers and protocol directors. And we will be coming forward through the main aisle and then returning to your seats on the center aisle. Thank you.
Today will be taken for the Hillsview Home for the Aged. The church also has other homes like the Hilarion Home in Satez and the St. Martin's Home in Crowshoe. So whatever collection is taken today It will be for the Hillsview home right here in Guelph. And at this time, we'll have the song, Men of Faith. And I really invite you to listen to the words of this song because it really speaks of the humanity of our condition, of the situations, the social situations that we face. And Sir Carlyle was very, very much a part of the life of the poor and suffering people. Men of Faith.
Thank you.
And so pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Be near, O Lord, we pray, to your servant, let Sir Carlyle Glean, on whose funeral day we offer you this sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to him, or any human fault have affected him, it may, by your loving gift, be forgiven and wiped away. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate this Eucharist. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take these, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of a new and eternal covenant, which we pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Thank you. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Clyde Martin our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Carlyle, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection.
Remember, Lord, also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face and have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
May the peace of Christ, and I know Sir Carlyle Glean, if you look at the photo of him here, is extending that peace really just by his whole demeanor. So may we live in peace as a sign really that his life would have impacted us. Let us become peacemakers.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be.
At this time, we are now going to proceed with Holy Communion. Once again, similar to the collection offering, the ushers and protocol directors will be providing support to this process, where folks will be coming up the main aisle and then returning to their seats at the side of the aisles. Thank you.
And as we receive Holy Communion, the choir will lead us in this song, "Let Us Enter Into Covenant." For the Lord really desires us to enter into covenant with him.
Oh,
presence of God is here. We can feel it, and I know you can yourselves. We've just sung this song, "Let Us Enter Into Covenant." Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God. He invites us to this marriage feast of the Lamb. As the priests who are here, and many of them have come to this funeral, the family being very faithful to the church as well. We now invite you to listen to this post-communion hymn, "I Thank My God," from Philippians 1, 3 to 11.
Let us pray. Be near. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant, let Sir Carlyle Glean, who today has joined me from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and free from sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Will we be seated, please?
On behalf of the family of the late Sir Carlyle Glean and Norma Lady Glean, which include family present, but those unable to join us in the physical today, including Andre Glean, Philip, Michael, Corey, and David, and the late Teresa Carter, and the many family of Dakotos who live abroad, we would like to extend our deepest gratitude to the Governor General of Grenada, Her Excellency Dame Cecile LaGrenade, Prime Minister of Grenada, Dr. the Right Honorable Keith Mitchell, and the many other officials that are present here today. Thank you for your presence and for the beautiful tributes that were shared early in the program. To the many persons who have performed duties during the ceremony today and throughout the course of the 3 days present, who supported the preparation for the state funeral and the celebration of life of my grandfather, we'd like to say thank you. So much support, coordination, and care goes into a funeral that has been quite tremendous and nothing short of remarkable. And so we want to thank everyone from the logistical coordination to the music preparation to the decorating of all the venues. Thank you so very much. Special thanks to the parish priest and the clergy and all those who assisted in the liturgy, and to the government information services and other members of the media. Thank you for providing coverage today. The family extends our love and appreciation to all those who provided care and support to Sir Carlyle Glean, and we especially want to thank reinforce our thanks and appreciation to Sister Marlene, Sister Roseanne Robertson, and Nurse Jones, and the many care providers and medical teams who provided care for Sir Carlyle Glean throughout the years. We thank each and every one of you for your expression of sympathy, support, and just for your very presence. Thank you for sharing your memories of him. It has been a joy to have learned of the impact. Oh, sorry, I can't see. It has been a joy to learn of the impact my granddad has had on the nation of Grenada, the Caribbean, and the diaspora. Thank you.
The fine work at adding her commentary to the team of commentators. And the final commendation will be led by Father Leroy Hopkin, Order of Preachers, OP. And the final commendation is a sign of great hope for all of us.
We enter through the door, whether it is the supermarket, the home, or the dance hall, we enter through the door. And when we leave, we live through the door, not through the window. I say that because we are going to use water here for the final commendation. And water is what is through water and the Spirit. Our brother Glean became a child of God. He was baptized with water and the Holy Spirit. And water was used. And water is so significant, so powerful, that we use water again now to tell us the same door that he entered life into. We are sending him back to his maker through that very door, through water and the Spirit. So we are going to, when the time comes, sprinkle the coffin with water again to remind us of that door that our brother entered into in becoming a child of God. Trusting in God, we have prayed together for our brother Carlyle Glean, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness. Let's all stand. There is sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see our brother Sir Carlyle Glean again and enjoy his friendship.
although this community or this congregation will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. The song of farewell. Saints of God, come to his aid, hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord.
Receive his soul and present him to God most high.
Brother, may Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham.
Receive his soul and present him to God most high.
Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. Into your hands, we commend the soul of our brother, Sir Carlyle Glean, your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead. In your sight, may he live forever. Forgive whatever sins he committed through human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace. We ask this through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Brother, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, and where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Amen.
Carry the casket back to the entrance of the church, and then you'll be taken to Douglaston Cemetery, and his body will be entombed. We already have a team that has gone ahead to be there to continue the coverage after the church. With me here still is
we
an experience, Ali. You know, I feel privileged to be here and from the Catholic media to be part of this commentary team. And just being here, you know, it's like I just felt some great hope for our country and how beautiful it is if we would all live together, respecting each other. You know, because the signs are here on the wall that this man has truly touched so many lives. He has been so close to his family. He has really been one who is a foundation that we will never forget.
Indeed, it was an honor and privilege to be part of the, say, the last chapter, the closing of the last chapter in the life and times of Sir Carlyle Glean, a true patriot, a national icon, a legend, a professor, lecturer, teacher, pupil teacher, a man who was a boy, sold fish before he attended classes, a man rising from humble beginnings who have achieved great things, who at the end of his public career was the head of state, our fifth governor general, a true Guelph man. You know, and as we celebrate his life, it is fitting that he received this celebration, this occasion. You know, I counted no less than 10 priests and deacons who attended this ceremony. Of course, the homily was given by his son, Carlyle Glean Jr. One of the readings were done by his grandson, Carlyle Glean Jr. III. And of course, the contribution of Sir Carlyle Glean to national development. In whatever little way, a life of service through education. And we're extremely proud of this son of the soil from Guelph, St. John's, who has done so well from the streets of Guelph. And one can imagine that in his days of youth, walking the streets befitted. One, I recall walking in the streets as Minister of Education, where he has achieved so much. Walking with a simple slippers through the throng of Guelph. Honorable, dignified son of the soil. Through all what he has accomplished, he has remained very humble.
Very humble. Grounded. You know, I was really touched by his early beginnings and the hardness of life. Because it seems, I don't know, I think of our young people today and how we are training them. We don't want them to do all of this stuff that we have done or how we have been brought up. But we tend to spoil them because we learn that anything in life doesn't come easily, any good thing. And it creates character and stature and prepares you for unknown situations and events in your life. And people wonder how you make it, but there was a foundation, you know? And I was really touched by that early beginnings of his life, and I really pray that more and more people will tell their stories to the young people and to not give them this false hope that life is just a bed of roses, and to be get the mettle to be able to face life and to cope with it. I can see that as in 89 years in this little man, he had such a small stature, but unassuming. But when he walked, it's like he was walking on wheels, you know, he had this smoothness about him and this sort of eye that passes. But he's picking up and he's remaining silent. He's really, truly one of our, as you said, we can't help but to be proud of him. And we see the evidence in his children and how the church is with him. He never, he was always planted here, just a stone's throw away from here, coming to church with his wife and his family. You know, there are so many things we can talk about, and I heard the tributes last night. I was truly touched when Aga Alexander said that he managed by walking around. He wanted to feel the pulse of what was going on. He was not locked in an office, but by moving, he was able to capture, to see the Paul Fort.
potential in people like Aga and persons who spoke about him and John Wright. And perhaps you too may have been touched by him in some way as well.
Just before we go any further, we must say that Troy Garvey has journeyed down to the cemetery to continue the commentary from that vantage point. So Carlyle is an inspiration, and his story is a testimony to persons who come from humble beginnings. Now, so often, it is so easy to make excuses as to why one fails, as to why one will turn to a life of crime, as to why one will drop out of school, as to why one will do something untoward. But yet for all, you have persons like Sokalai, who on his birth, I mean, you have to appreciate, he born in colonial Grenada. He born at the birth of Sokalai. Grenada was less than 100 years after emancipation of the slaves. So it's quite possible that at least his grandparents may have been slaves.
Yes.
And in those days, it was difficult times. And so Carlyle, you know, he was born in 1935. In those days, secondary school education was not open for all and sundry. You had to win a scholarship to go to attend secondary schools. And from these humble beginnings, he has achieved so much through education. Maybe he did not amass the greatest of wealth. He's not dying with the greatest affluence, but his life was so rich that...
That's his wealth.
That is his wealth, and he shared it with us, you know. He shared it with us, you know. Yeah. And I believe that the story of Sir Carlyle must be told to generations yet unborn.
Yes, yes.
As an inspiration to all of us Grenadians, that we can come from maybe nowhere, for want of a better word, and achieve so much.
Yes.
Through service and through sacrifice, through honesty, through integrity. At the same time, I believe the greatest hallmark of the character of Sir Carlyle was maintaining his humility throughout.
It's a gift.
You spoke about the way he walked and a dignified manner. As I indicated yesterday, the first time that I met Sir Carlyle was maybe when I was 15, 16 years, and he was campaigning for the NDC. And we young boys were playing cricket, I believe, at the time, and Sir Carlyle came and engaged us and so on, and crack a few jokes and so on. In his mild and simple, dignified and simple manner, that will always remain with me.
Yes, yes.
You know?
Yes. So, you know, it's been wonderful. They have already gone, making way to the Douglaston Cemetery, where his body remains, mm-hmm. will be interred. And so, where he's laid, it's a holy spot. And where anyone is laid, it's a very holy spot. As we learn, an angel stays there until its resurrection, as it were, that he will rise again. And we do admit that it was a joyful celebration, always filled with hope, no matter what it is, that we will see him again.
And you know? He's living, the hearse is living the street that where the church is that he went for all his years.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The first school that he would have taught in and the school that he attended is
came
on this
right
street.
Back, yes.
And
yes.
Of course, his place of residence for many years is on this street.
Yes.
So Sir Carlyle is leaving home for the final time.
Yes.
And may his soul rest in peace.
His spirit will certainly live on, and we really want to extend our own condolences to Lady Norma Glean. Very, you know, stood there like Mary at the feet of the cross.
Yes.
You know, and so I really am happy to have had this opportunity to be able to put my little bit from Good News Catholic Communications together with GIS. I think it's a wonderful experience, and we really look forward to continuing.
Yes, you know, a great tribute to Sir Carlyle. I just wish that his lasting legacy will be taught to generations, to children. I believe that in some respects, sometimes we as a nation, we as a people, we take for granted the lives and contributions that persons would have made.
Yes, yes.
So that when persons hear us now as we speak of Sir Carlyle and we say how great or how wonderful he is and so on, you know, the younger generations might not fully appreciate, because my, you know, one has to be mindful he's not as popular as, let's say, a Kirani James or an Ajamu or something like that, to, you know, but Sir Carlyle Glean made a tremendous contribution to the development of Grenada, not just Grenada, but education.
Exactly.
Throughout the Caribbean. He was the first lecturer in social studies at the University of Western Escaville campus. He lectured there, he played a critical role at the Caribbean Examination Council, you know. He lived a life, you know, he's a trailblazer in many respects, you know, and what a life, what a man.
Yes.
And it's heartening to see and to experience and to be part of this wonderful ceremony celebrating his life.
Yes. We know that seeds that are sown in love will bear fruit.
Yes.
So he's gone, but what he has sown will continue to live on, and others will catch the vision, as it were, and have that desire to continue. You know, I was thinking, someone said, could anything good come from Nazareth when Jesus was there? And sometimes people think, could anything good come? Yes, we had some very, very powerful, I mean, God raised up some persons from this community here. And we cannot, like Sir Paul School, you know, who came from here as well.
Yes.
And we had Kirani James, and I'm sure there are many other persons who have been.
Sir Donald Pierre.
Yes.
And just down the road, 4 or 5 miles away, we cannot forget Slinger Francisco, the mighty sparrow.
Yes.
And to a lot of Grenadians, Lewis Hamilton, the champion race car driver, his grandfather is from the community of Grand Roy as well. So we have sown some good seeds in this past.
Thanks be to God.
And we are grateful for all of the blessings. And of course, we have outstanding teachers. We have had 2 former police commissioners. And so, you know, one of the interesting things too is that so many of our governor generals, Sir Carlyle Glean, Sir
Reginald Palmer.
Reginald Palmer and Sir Paul.
Paul School.
They were all Paul School. Yes. They were all teachers. They were all teachers, the long life of teaching.
Yes.
And also, they are all authors. These 3 governor generals also wrote books. And we must ensure that these books are in our public library and made available to all of our students. In other words, these 3 gentlemen have left, not just their sub, they have left thoughts and ideas and knowledge with us in a tangible way.
Yes.
And I just thought that I should mention it. Very, very interesting.
That's good.
That we have these scholarly men, you know, who not only just served and contributed, but there are something that we can
resource
that we can refer to from time to time for wisdom and for knowledge. I believe we are getting ready now
to
hand over to Mr. Troy Garvey at the Douglaston Cemetery. Any minute now, the technical people will let us know when they're ready to do so. But it's been a pleasure to be here and to listen to you commentate on the funeral service and to share with the nation and I guess to the world what is happening, because we are all on these social platforms, and it was indeed a pleasure being here with you this afternoon.
I think it's my first time being so doing anything with you. I've seen you.
Yes.
But it's an
pleasure.
Opportunity to work with
Definitely
you as well.
A pleasure.
Yes. Thanks, Sherian.
So I believe now is the time for us to hand over to Mr. Troy Garvey at the Douglaston Cemetery.
Yes, so listeners and
over
viewers,
to you now.
Over to Douglaston Cemetery.
You should have never let me kill his John.
Good afternoon once again, and we are positioned right at the bottom street side of the Douglaston Cemetery in Guelph St. John's as we prepare for the final resting of Sir Carlyle Glean, the fifth serving Governor General of this nation. And as we speak for the first time, light showers are coming down as a procession led by a contingent from the Royal Grenadier Police Force, the Prison Services and Coast Guard. The two outriders to the front. The emblems of state, the national flag, and that of the Royal Grenadier Police Force in slow march. They advance to the cemetery. In the distance, we hear the sounds of the Royal Grenadier Police Force Band. And as the showers do come down, I've been so graced with the presence of an outstanding young lady from the Guelph area who provided the services of a red umbrella, so fitting at this time. Leading the contingent is that of Commissioner Edwin Martin, and he's accompanied by ACP Frank Mitchell and also the Commissioner of Prisons. The senior ranks of the Royal Grenadier Police Force now ascending and entering the Douglaston Cemetery. Brother Carlyle Glean. Funeral arrangements entrusted to LACPA brothers in St. George. And the hearse is escorted by sergeants of the Royal Grenadier Police Force and Coast Guard. And they are followed by the family, friends, and well-wishers. Indeed, a solemn moment for this country. But as mentioned in the eulogy and also in the homily, is a reason to celebrate and give thanks for so much. For Sir Carlyle has lived a full life, has given of himself to community and country, and with great distinction he has served, and served well. In a short while, the pallbearers, comprising of sergeants from the Royal Grenadier Police Force, will take the casket to the graveside, and thereafter a short service, and he will be entered into his final resting place. Sir Carlyle Glean, born the 11th of February, 1932, departing this life the 21st of December, 2021. And as we speak, the many bouquets and flowered arrangements being removed from the hearse, and in short timing, we will witness the removal of the casket from the hearse.
Watch.
What's that, man?
I don't know. I'm showing up there.
No, no, no.
Can you take some flowers up, please?
Tell him in the first place. Come, we have to take care of him. You, it is in what's that? Tell him.
Sorry, can you take some flowers up?
Yes, I will. I will.
We prepare for the final resting and interment of Sir Carlyle Glean. The minister who will perform the final rites has arrived, and he's accompanied by Carlyle Glean Jr. For those of you who are just joining us, we are at the Douglaston Cemetery in St. George, in St. John's, sorry. Members of the Royal Grenadier Police Force has already taken their positions to the top of the cemetery. And as we speak, the funeral director is removing the casket from the hearse, giving final instructions to the pallbearers. As I mentioned earlier, all sergeants from the Royal Grenadier Police Force. Eight members, pallbearers, God of honor is formed as we await the casket to be moved to his final resting place. Now we'll be moved to the shoulders of the pallbearers. Taken with caution and great care. The order from the staff sergeant to remove the casket from the shoulders to ensure easiest means of transporting. The approach would get great care and caution. The pallbearers moving the remains of Sir Carlyle to its place of interment.
Come and stay in the back.
A very back. Tedious challenge to move the remains to his final resting place. With great care, a job well done by the pallbearers. And so Carlyle Glean will be laid to his final resting place. As we speak, members of the family and his wife being accompanied by Carlyle Glean Jr.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, by the 3 days you lay in the tomb, you met fully the graves of all who believe in you. And even though their bodies lie in the earth, they trust that they, like you, rise again. Give Sir Carlyle Glean peaceful rest in this grave until that day when you, the resurrection and the life, will raise him up in glory. Then may he see the light of your presence, Lord Jesus, in the kingdom, where you live and reign forever and ever. Since Almighty God has called Sir Carlyle Glean from this life to himself, we commit his body to the earth from which it was made. Christ was the first to rise from the dead, and we know that he will raise up our mortal bodies to be like his in glory. We commend Sir Carlyle Glean to the Lord. May the Lord receive him into his peace and raise up his body on the last day. Through Christ our Lord. Eloquently, that the church, in her tribute to him, the advice he gave her upon assuming the office of Governor General. And again, she's here today, this afternoon, to pay her final respects. Let us pray for Sir Carlyle Glean. To our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. The man who believes in me will live, even if he dies. And every living person who puts his faith in me will never suffer eternal death. He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, hear us. Lord, you wept at the death of Lazarus, your friend, comfort us in our sorrow. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
You raise the dead to life. Give Carlyle Glean eternal life. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
You promise paradise to the thief who repented. Bring Carlyle Glean to the joys of heaven. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
He was washed clean in baptism and anointed with the oil of salvation, giving fellowship with your saints. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Comfort us in our sorrow at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Lord, listen to our prayers for Sir Carlyle Glean. Hath he always desired to do your will? So, in your mercy, forgive whatever wrong he may have done. By his Christian faith, he was united with all your believing people. Now, in love and mercy, give him a place with your angels and saints. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord.
And let the perpetual light shine upon him.
May he rest in peace.
Amen.
May the soul of Blessed Sir Carlyle Glean, and may the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Staff Sergeant given command. It will be folded and handed to a member of the family. Getting a very up-close view of the proceedings, the precision executed by the members of the Royal Grenadier Police Force. Sergeant presents to the Commissioner of Police, Mr. Edwin Martin, he accepts, we will deliver to the Governor General, Dame Cecilia Granada. And she, in turn, will deliver to the wife of Sir Carlyle Glean. One gun salute. What is evident, female officers of the RGPF being a part of the proceedings. Final pulse, an outstanding sun is laid to rest. And there's a continuous drizzle here at the cemetery, and we always like to consider it to be that of showers of blessings. Moments and nurses having some difficulty in removing the straps at the bottom of the casket. But I'm sure that will be rectified momentarily. As expected. And as we witness these final moments, the words of the son of Sir Carlyle comes to mind. It's an opportunity to say thank you. It's an opportunity to celebrate. It's an opportunity for us to be so thankful for a life well lived, a job well done. His tenure is over, and he will now seek eternal and everlasting rest. Still present, the Governor General, Dame Cecile LaGranada, Commissioner of Police, Edwin Martin, members of the family, the Royal Grenada Police Force Band to the rear, and scores of persons paying their final respects to this gentleman who took a long walk as a little boy to this area, not knowing where he was going, but on arrival, embracing and adjusting and elevating himself to the highest office of the land. What a story that should be told. Such a final moment when we witness remains laid his final resting place.
celebration. Prepare the tomb, the ceiling of the tomb. Still at the Douglaston Cemetery as the tomb is being sealed, placing the fifth serving Governor General of this nation in his final resting place. Governor General James Cecile Lagrenade is still here. Quietly observing the process of final resting for this gentleman, a good man. As he was eulogized and all the tributes. Oh.
The undertakers and persons still positioned here. The voices in the background singing the hymns we all grew up to and love.
Yeah.
moments of this ceremony. The ceiling of the tomb and the background music and beautiful voices giving that final send-off, that final farewell.
Oh,
The tomb has been sealed, and the final wreaths and arrangements being laid to the top. We witnessed a short while ago the laying of the wreath by the parliamentary representative for the area, and now we witness Commissioner Edwin Martin placing a wreath on the tomb and paying his final respects. The members of family will now be invited to do the same. Final moments here at the Dulverston Cemetery in the Grove St. John's, as we have just witnessed Sir Carlyle Glean, GCMG, being laid to his final resting place. He have served with distinction. We have heard he was a good man. All the tributes and the eulogy delivered today, and a fitting tribute to a great tenure on this earth. After a long walk from St. George's as a little boy to this area, he embraced the unknown, embraced this being his home. A nation paying tribute to a distinguished son who have served with great distinction. Born the 11th of February, 1932, and departed this life 21st December, 2021. As I mentioned earlier, a long walk took him to the parish of St. John's, and from there, he elevated himself to the highest office in the land. So this day is his final resting place here at the Douglaston Cemetery in St. John's. Sir Carlyle Glean, GCMG, may he rest in eternal peace. On behalf of the entire production team, on behalf of members of the family, the undertakers, and all those involved, we thank you so very much. And with the music in the background, the voices of St. John's, I say good afternoon and thank you very much. From the Douglaston Cemetery, I am Troy Garvey. Good afternoon.
That's not how you cross the pedestrian crossing.
Really?
One day I just woke up and I saw pedestrian crosswalks on the road. No one really showed me how to use them properly.
Well, this is how it's done. You never cross before doing these things. They might save your life. First, when you get to the crosswalk, you stop. You look left, you look right. If there's a vehicle coming, you put your hand out, making eye contact with the driver, indicating that you want to cross. And only when the vehicle comes to a complete stop, you quickly cross to the other side.
Stop, look, hand out, eye contact. Wait for pedestrian to cross to the other side, then you happily continue on your journey. This message is brought to you by this group of insurance companies, the Traffic Advisory Body, and the Traffic Department.
Are you a small business and would like your business to grow? Do you have an event, products, or services that people should know about? Be wise. Advertise. Book your spot on GBN Shopping Guide. Be part of Grenada's biggest advertising medium, the Grenada Broadcasting Network. Call our sales department now on 440-2446 or 440-3033 or GBN plus the number sign. Email us at sales@gbn.gd. Special conditions apply.